La Traviata by Giuseppe Verdi. It is hard to say, isn't it, why that music sounds so intensely nostalgic. Listening to those opening bars of the prelude to Verdi's La Traviata, we have an irresistible sense of a sort of musical déjà vu, as if we have been there, and it is our life that is being recalled. It is for this reason that many stage directors have chosen to stage the prelude. Instead of leaving the curtain decently down, they show Violetta on her deathbed, recalling in her mind the events of the opera we are about to encounter. We'll return in a moment to speculate on why that music bears the mark of authentic memory, but in the meantime, let's reflect a little on the young composer who created with this his 18th opera a scandal and a masterpiece. Verdi was born in 1813, and most of his early operas were based on biblical or distant historical subjects, as most operas were in those days. He spent his young manhood in what was in effect an occupied country. Austrian domination of northern Italy was a fact of his young life, and like most occupying forces, the Austrians practiced stern political censorship. So, for that matter, did the papal states that controlled central Italy. So, mythological subjects and stories of long ago were a safer bet in a paranoid and censor-ridden society. But La Traviata would run into another form of censorship, moral censorship. Nowadays, when we live in an age when attending opera is about as respectable a way as you'll find to pass an evening, it is hard for us to understand just how shocked our ancestors could be by the latest opera. The play and the film Amadeus reminded us of just how revolutionary, subversive even, The Marriage of Figaro appeared in its day. No assessment of the initial impact of Bizet's Carmen can fail to note that the heroine was a member of a despised minority. Carmen is a gypsy. Hardly a suitable person to be an operatic heroine. But worse still, the heroine of La Traviata is a prostitute. La Traviata, the woman who went astray, is the slightly comical literal translation. Call her what you will, audiences of Verdi's day, and for long after, were appalled that the maestro should choose such a character as his heroine. So it came to pass that the premiere was given not as Verdi had intended in modern dress, but in the ruffles and frills of an imaginary England of the time of Charles I. Amazingly, this tradition continued in whole or in part well through the 19th century, so that George Bernard Shaw, who in addition to being a playwright was also a music critic, could write in 1890 of Violetta in the latest Paris confections and Alfredo in full Louis XIV fig. Despite its moral problems, or maybe as a result of them, the role of Violetta is beloved of sopranos. It offers the most marvellous musical and dramatic opportunities to a singer-actress with what Verdi called the looks, soul, and good stage presence to command the role. The singer is given some of Verdi's greatest melodies. The role has its flashy moments, its moments of high drama, moments of great poignancy, and a very protracted death scene. Sentimental, yes, but what is life without a bit of sentimentality?